Well, I just restarted the stream because the connection was severed. Man, I don't know what that was. That was crazy. But anyways, just to recap, because I had to restart this video, I'm doing Steam Controller today. But first, I'm taking a break from doing Steam Controller because I was frustrated with it from earlier this morning. So I'm going to do this Xcode build thing, which is supposed to be 2 seconds faster on an incremental build. Yay. Okay, so it just built. So what do we got here in this XC build thing? Build output in the build directory. All right. This internet thing, right? Well, this is one of those days. Okay, so how do they recommend actually using it? I guess I got to put it in my path. All right, that's fine. Code source, Xcode build, build. Christmas, yeah, it was great. It was totally great. My lady and I exchanged gifts. We had a nice Christmas. We went and saw a friend. Yeah, man, it was great. What about yourself? How was your Christmas? Oh, yeah. You do remember one thing? There were several distinct looking dead trees in the game, and I kept thinking it would hold some kind of secret. Oh, yeah. Some of them actually do. So, yeah, so there's some that actually do give you a secret, and then they don't all give you a secret, because if they all gave you a secret, then it wouldn't really be that secret. So, I hear you on that. I do need to work on the secrets and make them a little bit more. Either just more of them, or, you know, work on the percentage of them that are that way, you know. All right, let's get one of these. So if we have code source, Xcode build. That's so cheating. I can't do this. I can't do it like that. Still learning Vim. Code source XC build. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it probably was like that. There's a lot of secrets. There are a lot of secrets. There's like at least 32 different secrets in the overworld. There's several secrets in each dungeon. There's a lot of secrets. Yeah, yours is great too. With the fam. You want your nephews open gifts? Cool. Nice. You had a good time playing? And I held your attention? Awesome. I'm glad to hear that. I'm really glad to hear that. I've gotten a lot of feedback like that from people saying they really enjoyed the game so far, and it's not even finished, so I think it'll get a lot better in the next couple months. But so far it kind of is, I guess it stands on it stands as a game that you can play right now, so that's cool. All right, so that didn't work. All right, why not? Oh no, there it is. Users nat code source XC build. What? Nice, Rune. Thank you, man. Thanks for sharing. I appreciate that. And I'll always be here if you have any feedback, if you want to give, you can get in touch with me here on the stream or email me or tweet to me or post something on the Steam forums. I look forward to making this, to finishing this game and finishing it as well as I could. It took you 9 hours and you were searching thoroughly. Cool. That's good to know. That's usually how long it takes me to complete a game of about this size, because I'm a thorough player too. I love to find all the secrets I can. Oh, nice! You streamed it. How'd that go? Nice. You highlighted the playthrough. Sweet. Oh, one sec. So I had to go streaming it. Were you able to select or to use the name Songbringer as the game you were playing? Oh, did I get the wrong? Oh yeah, this is supposed to be slash build. There we go. Oh no, that's okay, man. Oh, you're able to select it. Oh, that's cool. Nice. So a while back, people couldn't even select it or something. I think I got it. Yeah, it's from giantbomb.com, I think. Yeah, Giant Bomb, I think, is the one you got to get listed on. And that was kind of a bitch to get on. They really didn't want Songbringer on it because they're like, this isn't a released game yet. But anyways. All right, so let's see what happens. What can I use Xcode build now? Let's see. Might need a scheme. I definitely want to use Executor Ninja. Let's see if I can change the make file. One of the guys who watches sometimes is a large audience, though. Right on. Thanks, Rune. That's awesome. How did you enjoy? Did you enjoy streaming it? Like, do you stream games often? How does it compare to other games, like when you stream it? Oh yeah, I already got project scheme. So I should be able to just change this to XC build. And use Executor Ninja. But before I do that, back these up so we can switch to these pretty easily. Right on. Oh, Rune, one more question I have for you. How did you find the whole end game experience? When you and like when you crafted items, or when you when the Smith quest happened, did you do did you get the captain's note? Cool salad. Nice. Oh, that's sweet. Thanks, salad. Appreciate it. Okay, let's see if this works. Got to generate ninja files first. Where's it putting these? Oh, don't want the intermediates directory. Oh yeah, cool. What's up, baby? I'm streaming. I don't know. Leftovers or something? Okay. Cool, baby. Well, drive safe. See you home. All right. I know, all right. Songbringer dash. This is supposed to be put in not the Xcode's derived data folder. So that's one problem so far. It is doing the rapid build, I think, though. Yeah, Mac rapid. So wait a minute, did I do dash scheme? Yeah, I did dash scheme. Yeah, me neither. Okay, so that took 2 minutes. That's a long time. But I am streaming. That's maybe why it is. So if I make again though, it's pretty fast. Yeah, totally, me too. Okay, let's see what happens if I do the regular XC build. Nice, Rune. That's great. Yeah, that's great feedback. It's good to hear. I mean, that's what I'm going for. I want it to be a solid experience. All right, what's going on here? Oh, now it's basically remapped Xcode build to XC build. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yep, I don't have that much more time left with this game, so I've got to focus on the things that matter. So, what's up, Pedro? Yeah, Steam controller. Yay. Oh my gosh, I've had such a frustrating morning with the Steam controller. But I think it's time to get back to it. So it remapped my Xcode build command to their version of Xcode build, which is weird. Yeah, there's no way to activate the spheres yet, but yes, those will be a secret. Yeah. Good question. Good question. Yeah, those big black floaty sphere things. God, if anything, this is slower. Yeah, screw this. We need to do this the right way. So instead of just mapping all the way to there, we'll make an alias. Is that right? Is that the right way to do it? I don't know. Yeah, got a decent amount of interest through Kickstarter, yeah. It was enough to get the game going. It was surprised me. It was really surprised me. I mean, I did kind of like work on it for a good 4 months before, so I had really been focusing on building up a following before that and building up a prototype for the game first. So I think that's one thing, like on Kickstarter, if you just try and throw your game on Kickstarter, you're probably gonna fail. But if you prepare for it and you're mindful about it and you're trying to like actually do something good for people and you build it up over a few months before that, you can have a good chance of success, I think. Yeah. Yeah. Thanks, man. So yeah, it's gone really well. It's gone really, really well. This is in stark contrast to my last video game. My last video game was a complete flop, but I didn't try and do any marketing with it, you know, at first. Like, I built it with a friend. We spent a whole 2 years of our lives making this multiplayer MOBA cartoony kind of game, and we never marketed it at all. We never put any screenshots online. We didn't try and build a Twitter following. We didn't do anything, right? And then we tried to release it like that, just cold release it, and it was a big lesson in my life. Like, oh, wow, I guess you kind of do got to do your own marketing. You know, marketing is almost as important as development. So. Yeah. Oh, it's called Hero Bash. It's really not at all the same kind of style as Songbringer. But yeah, it's on my website at wizardfoo.com. So if you go to wizardfoo and then games, there's a link to Hero Bash. But yeah, I did the programming and the music for this, and my buddy did the art and the design. So this is his design. And then Songbringer is my own design, my own art, my own music and programming and stuff. So a little bit different. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, right. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You can't just pitch your idea on Kickstarter. You really got to actually put some effort in. So let's see if that works. So can we still call Xcode build? Oh yeah, we can. All right. And now if I go back to this and do a regular make. Yeah, cool. Now we're calling Xcode build, but wait, is it actually doing the right Xcode build? What's up, HD? Yes, I had a Merry Christmas. How about yourself, man? How was your Christmas? Wait, what? It's still using derived data? Okay, wait a minute. Can't complain? Right on. Did you drink eggnog? There. Okay, we're back to the regular Xcode build. Okay, so yes, there we've got a 2.5 second build. Now let's see how long it takes to do the same thing with XC build. XC build, command not found. So that's, I don't know if that's working. Rue, yeah, I stand up. Yep. This is a total like stand up situation. If only I could code from here. Tickety tack, tickety tack. Actually, beer. Lots of beer. Right on. Yeah. Okay, I'm not gonna fool around with this Xcode build anymore for right now. Let's get back to the Steam controller. Or should I do XC Pretty? Let's do XC Pretty real quick. Ergonomics. One thing on your playthrough, we went into the later dungeons way early and got the faster attack item. Oh, good for you, man. That's awesome. I'm glad you were able to get that. Isn't it? That's one of the things I like about Songbringer is that you can get into the higher dungeons whenever you want. You stole it, man. You went in and stole the higher item. That's rad. So I bet it made the game a lot easier for you, though. You had the bravery to do that, though. Was it easy to get that item? Because it should have been fairly hard to get that because there's a Verloc enemy in front of that getting that item and yeah. Yeah, I bet it made it a lot easier. The gloves, the faster attack item, they're pretty powerful. They're kind of necessary to beat some of the other guys. Gem. I don't use Ruby. Do I have gem? Oh, I have gem. That's crazy. How does this work? Gem install. What does that do? You ran like crazy past everything and happened to run into it? I don't know how you did that. That's crazy. Because there's supposed to be an enemy covering the door to get into that. Okay, well, let's see what this looks like with Xcode Pretty, huh? So we'll pipe our output into T and then into Xcode Pretty. Once I get out, you saw how high level the dungeon was. Oh, yeah. Right on. Good for you, dude. You had the courage to do that. You had the bravery to go into a high level dungeon and steal that item. That's awesome. So the game's also kind of meant to be like that because you're meant to be able to do it in any order. Like you can do reverse boss order. You don't even have to get the sword. There's a lot of like choices you can make as a player. Right on, Ishni. Oh, you might have used a bomb. Yeah, bombs are great. They're a super powerful item to get through some of those like harder sequences like that. That's kind of nice. XC Pretty. Right on. What if I had an error? Let's put an error in here. Okay. So there's Xcode Pretty. That's kind of a cool thing. All right, so enough playing around with stuff today. Let's get back to the Steam controller. Okay, so got things started. You're using the lighter? Yes, right on, Rune. I'm glad you figured out that you can use the lighter to kill those ghost guys. Yeah, dude, you really did it, man. You beat the whole game. You got number two on the scoreboard. You figured out just about everything. Props, man. Props. It's not an easy game. I guess it's probably easier with that glove, though. How far am I with story stuff? Well, I've got the most important story elements done, and I had originally thought that I would just do those. Like, right, I thought I was about like 80% done, but then after getting some feedback from people playing the game this month, I realized that there's not enough story yet. I don't want there to be too much story. I don't like games that are too story heavy, you know, where the whole game kind of revolves around the story. This is more of an action game. There's combat, and it's, you know, it's meant to be like that. There's supposed to meant to be a little bit of story, but not too much story. So there's more to do. There's probably like, now that I basically have drawn out like 10 more, well, not 10 more, but like about 6 to 8 more main story elements that are going to happen in most of the dungeons. So just about every dungeon will have like a something that's happening in the story. So just the story will progress more. At this point, like the game, if you play it right now, you get a little bit of story at the very beginning, and then you get a lot of story at the very end, and that's it, right? There's a huge gap in the story in the middle, and it doesn't really build up. There's a lot of things the story doesn't build up yet, and I want it to build up. First of all, like I want you to have an emotional attachment to the characters. Right now, you don't really have that much emotional attachment to Rock, the main hero, because it never explains any of his story or any of his background or anything or why he is the way he is. Same thing with Jib. It doesn't. You don't have any really a to You kind of have a little bit of emotional attachment to Jib because he's so kind of like cute and fun or whatever, and he's like your sidekick, but. Other than that, you know, it needs to build up a backstory for Jib too, but it also needs to like play up the tower. Why is the tower so, you know, what is the tower? What and it also needs to play up or start to build the story of why the enemies are on this planet, why you're fighting them and things like that. So the story's going to build up a lot more, and I think it's maybe like I don't know, there's at least like it's hard to put a percentage on it. Oh, you're number four? Right on. Oh, your playthrough is 7/10. But that you might have actually played the game for 8 hours. The playthrough part is just what the game records. So it doesn't record times you die, right? So if you go in, you die, it doesn't count that as time on your playthrough. Maybe it should. Maybe it should count your dies, your deaths into your playtime. Probably should, right? Shoot, now that I think about it. Yeah, I'm actually gonna put that on. Oh, is there a way to help the other friend that you find who has crashed? The one guy sitting next to the fire, there is a way to help him a little bit. Yeah, like a piece of the story in each dungeon, a lot like Zelda, yeah. Depends on what point in the playtime recording is. Yeah, exactly. I do want speedrunners to rely on it, so I should probably do that. I'm gonna add that to my list. Yeah, the guy that's hungry. Yes, there is a way to help him a little bit. So there's a way to get him to do something, but that's not finished either. So there's gonna be a little bit more of that I need to do, where he actually kind of joins back up with your whole crew. But yeah, for now, you can actually interact with him and get him to give you something. Yeah, so let's count the make sure the deaths are counted in your playtime. I want it to be accurate for speedrunners, right? If you're a speedrunner playing the game, and you die a few times, and that doesn't count towards your score. It's kind of sucks for the speedrunners that didn't die, right? It's not fair. Yeah, just shy of 8 hours. Nice. That's awesome. So did you play every dungeon then? Okay, so Steam controllers. The frustrating thing about Steam controllers is trying to get them all set up on Steam. It's horrible. Steam support is like really crappy. It doesn't work on Mac. Doesn't work on Linux at all. On Mac, it seems like it's gonna work, but it doesn't work on Mac. On Windows, it starts to work, but there's all these missing icons and stuff like that, so it makes it super duper frustrating to try and get to work. So anyways, enough complaining. I've kind of got it sort of working, even though I don't know how to map the start and select buttons because of what I think are bugs in the Steam controller configuration inside the Steam app itself. But I'm just going to ignore that and work on the API side of it right now. You swear you played every dungeon, but at the end, you didn't get number six. Oh, you know what? Number six, somebody was reporting that number six, they didn't get the achievement for it either. So let me, now that you mention it, it's probably just a bug. And I've got it on my list, so I will definitely check that out. Where is that? Yeah, sixth dungeon. There it is. Let me so also what was your world seed that you played on? I'll put that in my note here, so I'll check. It might be the world seed. Yeah, you probably didn't. Did you get did you do both there's, you know, the dungeon, there's the dungeon where you get the meditation, and that's the, I call those the swordless dungeons because you don't have the sword. Did you get two of those dungeons where you don't have the sword? Yeah. What's the name you gave at the beginning? Because you can play that same world again by just giving it the same name, or you can play a different world with a different name. Okay, yeah, so you did do two of the dungeons. So it's probably just a bug with the achievement. I'll be looking at that. Okay. Okay, so another frustrating thing about the Steam controller is the first command you're supposed to call is get connected controllers. This is supposed to tell you how many Steam controllers are connected to your computer right now, and this doesn't work. This freaking doesn't even work. It doesn't work on Mac and it doesn't work on Windows. I didn't try it on Linux. But this does not, this always returns zero. And then all the handles always return zero. But interestingly enough, if I pass it handle zero to these other functions that you're supposed to call after you get the handles, this actually works. Or what it seems like it's working. But beta QQ, all right. I will be checking that out. That's the second time that's been reported where the sixth dungeon just doesn't work. It's probably just like something, it's just probably a simple little bug on my end. Okay, so I could take this code and every time it goes and refreshes the controls, we can just see if that's actually doing something. So, we'll capture some Steam controller values. Let's see if this works. Oh, we need to store these controller handles, though. Yeah. The Xbox, PlayStation, PC gamepads, though, they all work perfectly. The problem with the freaking Steam controller is that Steam, in their infinite wisdom, decided not to support the regular gamepad libraries and everything. Every freaking other gamepad and joystick in the last 20 years has always used this one way of doing joysticks and gamepads. But no, the Steam controller decided to do everything on their own and release their own API, which you can only use their API to get it working. BS, man. The biggest derp was playing the puzzle with the two different colored tiles. You have to step on them to move the blocks up and down. Oh. You walked up on the little lily path up in the water. Oh, yeah. The walking along a lily path on the water is supposed to be a secret. Let me check that out in your world. Let's see what that was like. Hope that's not a bug. Just comment this out real quick. Take out this initial hurt too. Was it dungeon six? We'll find out. Oh yeah, different valve. Okay, so it wasn't six. Oh, your six was the sand dungeon. I think I might be at 60 frames a second. Okay, that's your seven. Maybe five. Let it bro, let it bro, let it bro. What's up, Mr. Frenic? They had to write a new API to enable the controller. But yeah. Yeah. It probably is, has to do with that. And they had a big idea with it, you know, with the two haptic controls and all that. I think they just should have supported the way that old gamepads work. You know, it would have made my life as a developer a hell of a lot easier. I wouldn't have had to code anything. So where was it that you would have to walk on the water to get through this? Oh, was it this? Oh, it's to the right. Oh, was it this one? I don't think it was this one. Right and down? Oh. Oh, look at this. Oh, you. Okay, check this out. So if you had. Hold on, if these were down. Oh, yeah, so if those were like that. Mean, you could have blinked, but that kind of would have been a bitch. But I guess you could have gone back to the entrance. You could run up on that little path in the water. Oh, so you warped onto it? Mean you blinked onto it? This is a crazy scream. Whoa, third-party API? Oh, you blinked onto it. Okay. Oh, okay, I get it now. Right. I see what you're saying about the loading path and all that. Okay. Yeah, so I guess you could have just gone to the beginning and, like, if you. I understand what you're saying. You didn't really understand how these worked or whatever. But you should have been able to just go do. Why did that one not go down? Oh, well, it worked here. But yeah, you should have been able to just do that. Oh, but then there's these guys are like this, though. Oh. Oh, now I see what you're saying. Okay, so you get over to this screen. So this is like. Yeah, no. This is actually the world. This is my bad. As a game player, you were doing everything right. You just probably got to this screen right here, and there's no way to get past this because those are already down, right? So you actually found a really cool workaround to be able to blink onto this little path right here. You like the purple here? Cool. Hey, what's up, Teak? Yeah, that's the only solution. That's the only way. You're actually lucky. You're lucky there was a path right here for that. So I'm gonna note this in my as a bug. So this particular screen right here, it really should not have had this little section of blocks right here in the middle. And honestly, it has a ton of these pulverizer guys that it really doesn't need to either. But yeah, you shouldn't have that there because it blocked off the path to this thing, which depends on that. So I'm just gonna kind of note this as a bug. 405. Nice. Thanks, Alan. You think you should really? I should leave it? All right. It felt good when you figured it out? All right. Cool. All right. Well, cool. Well, just it should. Okay. I should at least guarantee that. Well, yeah. Every world. Well. I'm trying to think like if there's any world where it might actually not have that little tiny path around it. I'll just note that as I'm not going to say fix that bug, but like just make sure that it'll work for those other situations. Where was I? It's cool. That's cool. That yeah. It kind of is a bug in the sense that the game shouldn't have put that puzzle behind that those walls because you have nothing there to s switch. Marcius, what's up, man? Yeah, right on. Welcome to the stream, man. I'll just make sure that every world can complete something like that. So this has blocks access to the toggle puzzle with toggles, sort of. Just was fun anyway, but make sure it works in other worlds. What's up, man? Well, I'm working on Steam controllers right now. So, what did I keep that? All right, cool. We got handles. All right, so I'm gonna go add something here to my controller listener thing for Steam handles. And then when it sets up controllers, it'll get the connected controllers. So even though this API reports that there's zero Steam controllers connected, I'm just going to use the API anyways and hope that that's just a bug. Yeah, you're figuring out CMake? Right on. I had to do that for Linux. CMake is great. I love CMake. I love CMake so much. I should honestly switch to it for Mac development too, and Windows. There's a lot of stuff to look up. At first, you're like, "What? How does this?" Let me show you my CMake. Maybe this helps. CMake policy. Set your app name, project. There's a lot to this. Oh, I'm using Kotire or Kotire. I'm not sure. Oh, how does the Kickstarter work? Where Kickstarter, actually, they don't take that much. Kickstarter takes like 5%, and then Amazon Payments or whatever they use for their payments thing also takes 5%. And so you're left with 90% of your profits. But then you've got to subtract all of your expenses, where a lot of Kickstarters expend a lot of money just creating rewards. With the game, hopefully most of your rewards are digital, but with my particular game, a couple rewards were not digital, like this poster. So this poster was, these cost me like $20 each or something like that, just to have, no, more like $15 just to have printed. But to have them shipped, it was like at least $10 in the States, but most of the people were out of the States, so it was like a $30 shipping fee or something like that, just to get it shipped. So you gotta count all your expenses too. And for most Kickstarters, you have a lot of expenses. You move from Visual to Sublime? Yes, CMake's great once you get it all set up. Yeah, I'm sure you're figuring all this out, Salad. This is my Linux one. But I should be able to convert this to actually work for Mac and Windows as well. It's long, right? It's a long thing. Yeah, it really does eat into your profits, yeah. Yep. But I think it was worth it, like there's some people out there that have this limited poster that no one else will ever have. I promised the people on the Kickstarter that they'd be the only ones to ever get that poster. So it's kind of cool. It's kind of a collector thing for them. I think I want to do another thing where I do like a cloth map. Am I planning to do another game? Yes, I will continue with the Songbringer series after this game. So I'm planning a few games in this series. This is just the kind of the beginning of the Songbringer story. Yeah, so I'll be continuing with this for quite a while, I imagine. And I'll do that even if the game fails, like even if Songbringer flops, even if I have to go get a job or something like that after this game, I'll continue on with this series because I really love it. It's just very rewarding for me to be making my own game all myself. Doing my own design and art especially is like so fulfilling for me because no one else tells me like, no, you can't do this, or we got to do it that way, or it'd be better for marketing if we did it this way. Like, oh God, it's those are such my whole life like has been working with other teams of people where I never really had complete creative control, and I guess I'm a creative control freak. When it comes to stuff like that, I want to be able to do whatever I want in a game, and so that's why Songbringer is so fulfilling for me, and I'll definitely continue with this series no matter what. Yeah, and Salad wants me to make the gym dating sim. Thanks, Salad. Appreciate it, man. Oh, sweet, dude. Yeah, dude, that's awesome. Thomas Happ's one of my heroes. Bite your tongue. Right on. I hope it is. I hope so that it becomes like that. But you never know. You never know. Like this game could it, I could release it on Steam and barely anybody could buy it. Who knows? And that would be really hard for me to make the next game, but I will do it anyways. Cropper, what's up? It has about. It depends on how thorough you are. But RuneWorld just took. Yeah, RuneWorld. RuneWorld just said. Yeah, man. Right, Rune, that's a good point. If you think about it, this game kind of already is a success because there's if you just look at how many people have supported the Kickstarter so far and people that have pre-ordered the game since the Kickstarter, it kind of already is its own little success, you know? Even if no one ever bought the game on Steam, it would still be a success in my mind to an extent. And I gotta remember that. Thanks, Ichni. Appreciate it. Yeah. I'm not trying to be negative or like say, oh, the game's not gonna do well. I'm just saying that I've learned my lesson before about getting my hopes up about games, you know, and I know that sometimes things don't work out the way you planned. So you just kind of like gotta, I don't know. It's such a, I'm wondering how the hell do you do that? How the hell do you, what kind of expectations are you supposed to have as a game developer? Are you supposed to expect your game to succeed? And then if it fails, you're heartbroken? Or are you supposed to not have any expectations at all and just let your game do whatever it does? I don't even know. Have not figured that out in life yet. Just wondering how much content to try for in the first part if you go that route. Oh, right. I would say if you're trying to make a game like this, try and go for content that's like, I don't know, 2 to 4 hours long, and then make it so there's lots of secrets or optional things, and then for people that are thorough, they'll play it a lot longer. Thanks, Rune. Yeah. Mr. Frenick, oh, expect the best, but prepare for the worst. It's one way to approach it. Each need plan for the worst, hope for the best, right? Shoot for the moon and prepare to fall down the Grand Canyon. Right? I like that. I like it that way. That's a good way to put it. So I'm just gonna loop over each one of these controllers. Actually, I'm just gonna do the first controller because it doesn't tell me how many controllers there are. Oh, thanks, Cropper. I hope so. I hope so. I guess we'll all find out when this game gets released. We'll find out like, okay. And maybe after the game gets released, I'll have some more like feedback, or maybe I'll write another article on Gamma Sutra about that, about expectations, because that's a huge thing on my mind lately, is like, what am I supposed to expect? So we're gonna loop over each like action. So I've got these actions like. Let's switch to Vim. I miss Vim. Was that? Controller. So each one of these actions, we'll do up. Whoops. Down, left, right, A. I think I call them select and start. Thanks, Rune. Teak, pro tip, never try to fundamentally change the way your light system works after it's optimized to hell. Oh no. Oh man. What? Oh, this is not what the one I did. I think it's select and start. Wait, I think I put it in game actions. Here we go. Yeah, start and select. Okay, this is the one I named them. I think that's What? Okay, so for each one of these action names, we'll get an action handle, get the data handle. And if data handle, what are these? I think it's like B selected or something. I don't know. You're trying to get enough gameplay to make a really polished demo? Right on, a prologue. Sweet, man. What's up, baby? Oh, that's right.
You shocked me. Mm-hmm.
Oh no, now it doesn't work. Oh, it's time to check the Git repo. So this data handle thing, oh, it's a struct with B state. B state is currently pressed. So it's just B state. If data handle B state, then we're gonna add to the currently pressed values. Okay, Rune. Thanks, man. Later, dude. Thanks a lot. So, pressed values. What the hell is pressed values again? Paired.first is the button code. Man, some things Vim is not as good for. Okay, so it's not data handle. It's data handle dot. And each one of these things needs its own code. And we're also going to need to like match all these up to okay, let's create a little simple structure or a pair, like a pair of code to yeah, so let's go auto base code or actually UN32 type base code. So I don't know what the Steam controller, I use a 4-letter hexadecimal code for each controller, and I don't know what the Steam controller is going to currently be, so I'm just going to use AAAAA for now. So the base code is OXAAAA0000, and we'll pick a list of pairs or a vector of pair. And the pair is going to be a UINT32 type to, or I can make a map. Actually, let's do a map. map of UINT32. Actually, oh, we're gonna have some of these might have the same code. So this needs to be a map of strings to UINT32s. We'll call this actions. Figuring out why it doesn't work? Oh no. So like actions up, for example, will be base code or K gamepad button. X is one positive. Actually, let's mimic, you're gonna sleep on it? That's a good solution, man. Sleeping on it always works for me. Always. We use controller face. So I'm just gonna mimic the way the PlayStation 4 controller works. I'm gonna mimic all its commands so I don't have to rebind anything for this. So X is two minus is up. Down is gonna be, you know, something else. Up, down, left, right, A, B, X, Y, L, R, select, start. Definitely, let it stew, let it simmer. So this is probably axis to positive, down. Okay, so left is axis one negative, right's probably gonna be one positive. A, it's button two. B is button three. X is button one, Y is button four, L is button five, R is button six, select is button nine, start is button 10. All right. So now we can loop over these pairs. And then the action is paired up first. And I think Steam is expecting it as a C*. So and this will be pair.second. What the hell is press values? Right, map of input code type to bool. Whether it's pressed or whether it's released. Okay, so if the button's down, we'll do press value. Otherwise, we'll do a release value. Just to see if this even works. So all I'm trying to do is figure out if the Steam API even works for the buttons, because it's reporting zero controllers on Mac and Windows. Everything I tried. Really frustrating API to work with. Here goes. Let's turn on controller verbosity. Let's see if the Steam controller works with their API. Yeah, you got an idea. Oh. Nothing. But wait, did it even do the release value? Hold on, is it even getting here? Oh, it is. Okay. So this should be Steam handles I. So we're getting an action handle, which does return a value. That's good. Number 5, data handle. Action handle 6. Action handle 9. So it's returning me action handles, but it's not. I don't know if it's ever returning any actual values. Nice, new vid. Wow, man. This is looking awesome. Look at that. It's awesome. Whoa. Sweet, look at that. You're only at 25 draw calls, too. Super efficient. Spotlights. Yeah, I love this isometric view. This is cool. Ooh, emissive materials. It's all glowy. Sweet. Oh. That's awesome. Oh, these are animated materials. Okay. Dude, I hope you're proud, man. This is awesome. And it's pegged above 60 frames a second the whole time. Oh, it got down to 57. Oh. Yeah, most of the time, though, it's like 50, 66 frames a second or something crazy. That's awesome, man. Wow. Nice work. Okay, well, I don't know what to do about this Steam controller, man. It doesn't work. The API doesn't work, and also trying to map things inside the... So it just returns that there's zero controllers connected, even though I have one connected. Do I have to press the Steam button? That brings up like my Steam overlay thing. Try unplugging the control. Whoa, what's going on? Steam Bake controller mode. Oh no, I didn't. I missed that. What was that you're saying about issuing native Steam controller support? What's up, TM Game Dev? What is B state? You mean like what is it as a variable? It's a variable that's supposed to represent whether the button is down, but it's not returning anything for any of the buttons. So what, hold on, let's try unplugging the Steam controller. So wait, when did you say that earlier? What was it you said? About issuing native Steam controller support. Yay, the controller's connected. It's made the lovely noise. Nothing. None of the buttons work. Played Songbringer with the Steam controller and it worked fine. Yeah, I already did this. I just set a breakpoint there. Yeah, everything, it gets all these. So I already did this. It gets this action handle for each one of these actions just fine, right? So it's acting like, yeah, it knows that there's an action associated with each one of these things. In fact, let's try and give it something that's not an action. Like, here, we'll add another one. We'll call it like that. We'll set a breakpoint here and see if that fails. So how do you do that, Salad? How would I actually treat it as X input? Because if I could do that, I should have just done it a long time ago. Maybe that's my main frustration is I thought that they didn't allow you to treat a Steam controller as a regular joystick/gamepad. Okay, let's see if this works. So we're gonna call a bogus. Oh no, this is not a bogus one. This is ABLRXY. Here we go. As a visible. Action handle 0. All right, good. So that's not an actual. So it's recognizing, it is successfully recognizing these actions, but it's not recognizing the controller. So the problem here is not this. This is somewhat working, right? It's that it's not even recognizing the controller at all. I call get connected controllers and it returns 0. Let's set a breakpoint here just to verify that. Not using the Steam Controller API at all? But I had it that way for, so how did you get it working then? How did you play Songbringer and like, were you able to use all of the Steam Controller's features? Were you able to use the haptic feedback and all that? Okay, so there. It calls this get connected controllers. Even though it's definitely connected, it just made the noise. And I've also made sure that it's not set to I had some setting in here just to make sure that the controller didn't shut itself off after a while. So here, it returns 0 for the number of Steam controllers, and then it also returns 0 for all of the actual handles. So it's like it doesn't give me access to the controller because all these are 0. This is the problem. So why? Why is this API so being like this, huh? I guess I would probably need to call run frame, even though I think I'm calling Steam API run callbacks. Yeah, it's calling this already. But maybe, just maybe. Maybe this is necessary to be called like once. Before it does that. Hey, what's up, Kovarni? You're not sleeping at night. You did what you do with any game. You set up the Steam controller, configure how you want it, and then ran the game. It was detected as a gamepad. I didn't really use the haptic feedback since there wasn't much reason to. Huh, I don't know why I had so much trouble with that. I'll show you in a second. I'll actually go in there and try and bind the controls. I don't want to show the binding panel. I've gotten action set handles fine. Might need to call this activate action set as well. Get digital action handle, get data, origins, action handle. Trigger a haptic pulse. Get gamepad index for controller. If emulating a gamepad. Get motion data, show. Okay, so the only thing I've seen is maybe this. Maybe the activate an action set. And also this run frame. Let's see if that works. What's up, Raikou? Isn't the game finished? No. It'll be finished in a few months or so. Who knows? Yeah, I know it can output keyboard signals. I didn't know it could actually output gamepad signals. I didn't know that. How do you? Oh, I'll have to go into the thing and try it here in a second. Okay, so if this works, then we'll get an N Steam controllers and the handles will be full. Now, handles are all still zero and the number of Steam controllers is still zero. The API just like doesn't say there's anything. It says there's zero controllers. Man. So maybe we need to use an action set. We need an action set handle. And we'll see what return value we get from that. Okay, so it does output X input on Windows. SDL has support? Really? Oh, I could just try it right now then. Oh, this is void. Okay, let's see if that works still though. If SDL already has support, I'll open up their library right now and try it. I had that. I was using that last week for doing Rumble. Nothing. Yeah, let's try SDL. See if maybe their code does something magical. It just makes it work. Let's hope. That would be awesome. So this is the test haptic. Yeah, so the thing is that Songbringer already works with IOKit and X input and all that, and I didn't know how to get that working on Steam. Like, I don't know how to do the controller config thing. I've been doing that all morning, and it was just super frustrating because all the buttons were empty and blank and stuff. Okay, let's see what happens if I just run it. Yeah, so here's SDLs out. SDLs give me the same thing. It says zero haptic devices connected. But let's see if they got another kind of. Here's test joystick. Let's try that. Maybe my Steam controller's broken. Doesn't seem like it though. Yeah, there's zero joysticks attached. This is SDL 2.05. It doesn't have haptic. It does. Yeah, it does have haptic support on OS X. Yeah, I was testing all this last week. It has all this awesome haptic rumble and everything. It's great. It totally works. So this joystick, what is it supposed to do? Joystick init. Num joysticks. Joystick open. What's this game controller thing? Is there like a test gamepad or something? Game controller, maybe that. Steam controller config, you have to do, yeah, big picture and go to man. Yeah, I was doing all that this morning, but I'll show you what I mean. It's all messed up. It like doesn't show me anything. Once again, it's showing me there's zero game controllers, even with SDL's code. No, not 2.5. This is 2.0.5. Okay, I'll show you what I mean about. Man, I thought this would have been helpful, but I guess not. Maybe there is some code for getting it started on Steam. What is there? Yeah, SDL doesn't look like there's anything. Are you serious? No Steam controller? Nothing. Nothing about Steam at all in the SDL. Okay, well, I'm closing that. You have to launch the game through Steam in order for the controller to use something other than its desktop layout. Oh, really? Maybe that's the whole key to it all then. Oh. You can modify that desktop profile, the Outpack gamepad stuff instead though. Okay, let me get in here and let me see if you can help me out because I have no clue about this. Okay, so here I am in Steam. I'm gonna go to big picture mode. Ooh. All right, so I got my Steam controller and I'll use that to navigate, and it works. See, I'm using my Steam controller to like navigate everything. I'll go to library, Songbringer, manage game. What? Where did the controller config icon go? What? This was working. This had a button like I'm closing Steam. The controller outputs for that configuration only when that process is active. God, this could be why I was having so much frustration this morning. Okay, let me try exiting Steam. It was, yeah, it was there this morning. Right, Teek. See you, man. Yeah, as soon as they go into big picture mode, Steam uses so much CPU or GPU, I'm not sure. Okay, let's try this again. Good night. There, it's there this time. Right, controller config. Whoa. So here's the problem. There's nothing for the triggers. Right? I can't do anything for the triggers. There's supposed to be icons and text and stuff here for the triggers. And for the select and start, I can't even map these at all. No matter if I click on stuff, I can't do anything. If I use the Steam controller to move around, I can move around to these four things and also this middle gyro thing, but there's no way to move up here to go and select like the triggers or the select and start buttons. So this is all I've gotten so far. And sometimes when I go into this screen, it won't even let me bind buttons. It only lets me bind like a D-pad. And then on Windows, it was a little bit better, but it still didn't have any of these icons. So okay, let me just try and do it this without even doing an official configuration. Let's browse configs. And so how would I go and create a configuration that would supposedly use X input and IO kit? I guess I would use a template, right? I guess I would probably use gamepad because it's not a gamepad with camera controls or high precision or mouse and gyro. Just gamepad. Okay, and see this allows me to actually use, map everything now. But how do I actually map it to the? So I want X to be X, not a keyboard thing. I want it to be the button X on the controller. One of these a controller. Thank you. Did I lose you guys? The stream just stopped working? Looks like it's still working. I don't know how to do this. Like, how do I map the button X to just be X? Oh, it's already set? Controller diagram on the... Oh. Oh! Okay, so X is X. Oh! Okay. God, why is it so hard for me? So maybe everything is already set up the right way. That's already start. Let's try this out. If I just like say B done, and then play. And it says there's a controller connected. Oh my god, it works! This is all you have to do? Okay, let's see if we can have the haptic stuff. Ah, what? What the hell? Interface tick. So, all right. I'm thinking what I need to do to get this working. Yeah? I think what I have to do to get this working is to, like you were saying, to run it from Steam. I think that's critical. Something about that, right? So I need to actually get it to run my debug version of Songbringer when I run Steam. All right, this is an old version of interface as well, so. Seeing that it crashed in interface tick 2331. Oh, that's in interface tick. Well, let's see where that was actually crashed at. Sure. Yeah, I think I did turn Rumble on already. It crashed Steam too. You can modify the Steam controller's desktop profile. So show me that. Where do you go for the desktop profile? Steam. Yeah. So you got to show me this. How do I go modify a Steam controller's desktop profile? Rumble works at first. I just want to be able to actually develop with their API. Okay, I think you're talking about controller options. So yeah, here's where I set the shutdown to never. And I think I have Rumble on. Is this what you mean? Yeah, experimental Rumble emulations on. Okay, oh, I'm already at the gear icon. Oh, sweet. Okay, so where do I go after that? Base configurations, maybe? Oh, base configurations. Oh, okay, so when you're not playing a game, your Steam controller will use these default configurations. What? Oh! So desktop configuration. Oh, I get it now. So this is what it's using when a game is not playing. Oh, and then I could go and like browse configs and add a config or whatever, like for my game. Okay. I think what I'm going to do is set it up so I it actually runs, it can run the Steam game from my, so I'm this big picture mode is like, right, you want it to launch from within Steam, right? Sure, that'd be great. Are you going to order it and come back with it, or are you going to order when you get here? Oh, okay. Okay. I'll have 7 cents. We'll have that. It sounds great.
Okay.
Okay.
You can order it if you want to. You can go and do
You already know what you want to order? You make a list?
No, but you want the yellow curry, and I want like a noodle dish and chicken.
We just, if you want me to order, we just write down what you want to order or put on. Okay. Right, let's exit big picture. If you decide to upgrade to 32, yeah, you can just pay the difference. There's, it's on the, it's on the Steam or on the on songbringer.com/pre-order. There's a little button here at the bottom for this PayPal button just to upgrade. So this will upgrade you from 16 to 32. So you want to do that? Do make sure and email me after you do this though, because I have to like manually apply it. So I have to go in like and take your existing order and upgrade it manually, and then manually send you a Steam key. So do email me. If you need my email, it's nat@wizardfoo.com. Nat@wizardfoo. Well, let's hope it does. No, Code Tinkery, no. Songbringer is not already on Steam as a game you can buy. It's not released. It's not early access. But it is on Steam in the sense that if you're playing the beta version, it's there. So you need to have a beta key. You basically need to pay the $32 version right there on that website I was just showing here, songbringer.com/pre-order. You can order the $32 version and get yourself a beta key and play it on Steam right now, but it's not for sale on Steam yet. Oh, cool. All right, nice. Nice. All right, so let's, okay, what I'm gonna do next is try and run my debug version of Songbringer from Steam. So let's go to the Steam app directory and go into the Mac folder. Oh, this is old. Okay, so I'm gonna go into the Songbringer app. Wait, no, I'll just move this one as if to like a backup. And then symlink to my debug version. What's up, Teleron? Debug Songbringer app. There we go. Okay, there. I should be able to run the game from Steam now. And hopefully, wait. Oh, their API did say something about how Oh, I could just look at the log. So we've got I got some stuff already in the log, which says the number of Steam controllers. So if this says one Steam controller, then it will have worked. So I'm running it from Steam. Should be running the debug version with the debug data. Yeah, it is. Nice. Okay, now I can quit and see if the log.txt says one Steam controller. If that, oh my God, it freaking worked. Oh. All right, HD, we'll see you, man. Later. Put my CMakes. Yeah, sure, man. Totally. Let me do that for you right now. This is such a huge victory, though. Thank you, Salad. A lot of this is thanks to you, man. One Steam controller. That's all I needed to see. Oh my God, I can't believe that worked. So okay. Anybody watching this stream, the point of all this is basically if you want to get your Steam controller API working, you have to run it from the Steam client, or else you can ch there's that whole thing where you can change your desktop mode or whatever, but this is where you run in B because this is where you actually have to, like, debug your game. So yes, this is huge. But yeah, let me show you my C make. Can we just do you want me to email it to you? Email would be cool. Yeah, why don't you can you email me, Saad? Just send me an email and I'll send you my CMake lists after the stream. I don't really have anywhere else to put it. I could put it on GitHub, I guess. But it's not really like something that I don't think it would help a lot of people. I'm not sure that. Hold on. Would this be helpful? Maybe. Okay, cool. Yeah, just email me. I think that's easier because I don't think this is like something that necessarily like a lot of people would get benefit out of because it's so specific to Songbringer. But if you're setting up a CMake, I can see why this would be helpful. Just to like look at a few things, be like, oh, there's how you would do that or whatever. Okay, man. Oh, that's so awesome. So we can get Steam Controller. I wonder if it still returns. Let's see if it can actually use the Steam API for buttons and all that. Oh, you're looking? Okay. I'll just put it on gist or whatever. If that's, yeah. If that's helpful, I'll do that for sure. Okay, so I'll just put it here. You make lists? Yeah, lists. You sent the email? All right. Well, here you go. Here's nice, right on. Well, there you go. Hopefully that's helpful. Yeah, of course. Gladly. I think my vimrc is on there too. There's a few other things that might be helpful up there. It's kind of an old vimrc, but okay. Now we can run from here and see if the buttons and stuff actually work. I'm not sure if I changed my gamepad config though. My God. totally working. Oh man, this is such a relief. Right on. There's a lot of stuff, it's very dirty. There's lots of stuff commented out and just like, it's kind of unorganized, but hopefully you get the gist. Literally, the gist. The gist that get up. Okay, so this is great. We're getting feedback, or like the buttons are being registered, but they're not like, they're not like being translated into actual buttons, but that doesn't matter. It really doesn't even matter, because now that these accesses and buttons and things like that are actually coming through, and the number of Steam controllers is like, okay, this is huge. Man, that's so helpful. Thank you, Salad. All right, so this is gonna be pretty simple. I'm sure I'll figure this out later on tonight. I'm gonna close the stream down for now, because I gotta take a deep breath, maybe meditate for a while. This was frustrating me to no end all day. I was like, the Steam API just doesn't work. It doesn't freaking work. I know, right? This is a huge milestone. Just to get the buttons registered. Just to have, like, the axes returning values. So great. We're on the way to getting this to actually work. Yes, yes, you totally did. All right, guys. Well, so that's going to be it for today's stream. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for your help. And for your support, everybody. So we'll catch you all next time. And yeah, hope you all are having a nice holiday. See ya later.